Nancy and I both hold Johnny Oxendine in high esteem. We've known him at least 16 years, because that's when Keith moved out to California. So it's been our privilege to have been friends with both him and his wife, Pamela. And, of course, we know their daughter, Leslie, and her husband, Jeremy, and son, Andrew. We, of course, have been out to California quite a number of times, and we know the members there quite well, so we're just thinking of a great privilege to be able to consider Johnny a good friend, and even more so that he's a faithful gospel preacher. He was educated in North Carolina, University of North Carolina system, and he got a business degree. We can believe it, can't we? Yeah, we can believe it. They just think that they can't believe it. But he's preaching a number of meetings around, and he continues to co-direct the English lectures in England with Keith Sisman for a number of years now, and he'll do it again this year, I'm sure. So he's going to speak to us on the subject of the fatal error on John 3, verse 5. So, Johnny, if you'll come speak to us, appreciate it.
It is always a joy to come back here, be a part of this series, and commend the brethren here, the elders especially, and of course, Brother David for everything that is done to make this, and Sonia, for everything that is done to make this successful. A few minutes ago, I was looking over my notes, and Michael, of course, tried to take them away, and there's been an ongoing, not battle really, but we have Michael who doesn't use any books anymore, everything's on his iPad, and Brother Daniel Denham, who cries because Michael ripped up all of his books. So Michael, I was sitting there, and Michael's behind me, he says, "That's just a shame that you're using up that paper." Yeah. I thought, well, here we go. Tonight, what we'd like to look at, of course, is the fatal error on John 3, 5. This will be more of an unfolding narrative, of course, when we look at this and take into consideration, I want to take into consideration that when I get to the end or near the end, that some of the things that we'll be going over will simply be unbelievable. Some of the writing that we're going to look at, it's hard to imagine that a grown man could write some of these things. And it's going to be even harder for you to understand what I'm reading as I'm reading it. But I want to prepare you so you're not falling out of your chairs or anything like that. Of course, as we begin, the narrative that we're looking at, Nicodemus, of course, ruler of the Jews, he has come to see Jesus by night. We know that he spoke to Jesus in this particular way. No man can do these things, these miracles that thou doest, except God be with him. And the conversation went on, and Jesus said to him, "Except a man be born of water and of spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." Now, as we read through the lectureship book, and of course, as you've been listening to the speakers, a lot of things overlap, but one thing remains the same, and that's that the Bible is true. And as we look at these verses and try to go through them, and we ask ourselves, how is it that someone could come up with such a wrong-headed view of what these scriptures actually mean? Of course, the verses in John 3, 1 through 5, some of the most well-known, often studied, dissected, and widely quoted in all the scriptures. And they're well-known for many different reasons, and every Christian should understand not only what they mean, but the Christians should understand what the error in these particular areas are as well, so that they can defend the gospel. And we say, as the title, The Fatal Error, and this has been described a number of times, what does that mean? And of course, we say fatal error. We say error in biblical interpretation is fatal. And in this specific case, of course, because the misinterpretation and misrepresentation and misapplication of these verses is false doctrine. It's just false doctrine. And false doctrine will cause a person to lose their soul. If they continue down that path of false teaching, false doctrine, condoning fellowship, and all of those things that go around it, of course, a person will miss eternal salvation. And we say false doctrine because the most common misinterpretation and representation, misrepresentation of this verse is one that points to the idea or tries to give the impression of a duality, more than one baptism. A water baptism and a separate spirit baptism. And not only is this false doctrinally, but the notion of two baptisms gives rise to the many ideas of the direct operation of the Holy Spirit doctrine perpetuated by many people in religious organizations and, as we have been looking at through the course of this lectureship, MacDeaver. A few years ago, Brother Gary Summers wrote a series of articles on the widening spread of this particular doctrine, especially among those, as we would describe them, as church-affiliated universities or colleges. And these articles appeared in both the Defender and the Contending for the Faith. So we want to look at these verses, and of course, as we continue to move through them, to ask ourselves some questions as we go along the way. We'll look at, of course, the word baptism. And baptism, again, that's a word that's been defined and described and in your Bible classes, in the sermons. We're not going to go through what baptism itself is, but we know that it has endured countless attempts to diminish its importance. And, of course, the biblical meaning and the power that we see in the scriptures attributed to it. And as we say, despite all of these efforts, the meaning has not and cannot be changed from what it meant at the time of its use and at the time of the writing of the New Testament documents. It still carries the meaning of a total immersion in water. One of the best recent chapters on baptism, at least this is my opinion, and if you don't agree with it, you can see the person who wrote it, was found in the 2012 Bellevue Lecture Book, What the Bible Says About, by Brother Dub McClish. If you haven't read it, do so. It's excellent. It's concise, but it contains only what the scriptures say on that subject. It is a marvelous chapter. We go through the lectureship books often in San Mateo, and we went through the chapters of that particular book, and everyone was just enamored by Brother McClish's handling of the subject in that particular lectureship. The significance of this immersion or plunging or dipping as it relates to our relationship to Christ, we're going to look at that as it is found through a number of passages that are in the book. We're going to look at the one from Romans chapter 6, verses 3 through 5. Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, and like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in the newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. We know that we've heard this many, many times, but we're going to move through a few other verses before we come back to the one in Romans, Acts. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made, this is Acts chapter 2, verses 36 through 38. And this, of course, is the sermon preached on the day of Pentecost. That same Jesus, whom ye crucified, both Lord and Christ, now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, Men and brethren, what shall we do? Peter said unto them, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. The last set of verses that we'll read before we move a little further along is Acts 8, verses 36 through 38. And as they went on their way, they came to a certain water, and the eunuch said, See, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? He had been taught enough. He knew that there was a responsibility that he had to the gospel, that being baptism. See, here's water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? We would all love to hear that, wouldn't we, when we teach people. Someone who, with a sincerity of heart, understands what it is that God requires them to do, and just ask, well, why can't I be baptized right now? I've only heard that once in a Bible class in the church building. They said, Can I be baptized right now? And the fellow who asked was so big, and we wanted to get him down and under so, you know, quickly enough that we had to go to someone else's house, and was a jacuzzi or something, and I had to almost just lay on him to get him under the water. He was huge. Anyway, preachers always have some stories. And Philip said, If thou believest with all thy heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And he commanded the chariot to stand still. And they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. There are a lot of things in that particular set of verses that speak to various points on baptism that a lot of people in the religious world are uncomfortable with. The idea of going down into the water, the idea of many of these particular points that are found there. But let's go back a little bit. We look at the quote from Romans. It speaks to the transformational power of baptism. And we ask ourselves, what does baptism do? It places us in the kingdom of the only begotten Son. It transports us into a newness of life, which means that when we come out of the waters of baptism, we are a new creature, a new creation. We are no longer the person that we were, and we are now confessing or professing Him before men. Later in the book of Romans, chapter 12, Paul speaks of our being transformed as we renew our mind. Essentially becoming these new creatures, these new creations, ever learning more and more of our responsibilities to God and the ability to understand His word even more. Even more, these verses show our connection to Christ through baptism. Our death in baptism, a putting away of the old man of sin. Romans 6:6. And this is only possible through the blood of Christ. Our resurrection is into the Christian life. It is not we who live, but Christ who lives in through us. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I yet live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Now, I read through that quickly, but there's a lot being said right there. It is this act of baptism that ushers our entrance into the church, the kingdom of God, and the Lord adds us to the church when we're baptized. The church of Christ is the saved, and the Lord is the Savior of the church, Ephesians 5:23. So one cannot be saved before one is baptized. And one also will not be saved if not baptized, Mark 16. But one will be saved by baptism, 1 Peter 3:21. When we look at the passages in Acts chapter 2, And there, of course, Peter is responding to the question posed by those who had heard the gospel message. They finally came to understand their plight. They came to understand their sin in the sight of God. Would that it were more people who came to that understanding in the world in which we live. And they wanted to know, how do I rectify this situation? What do I do about this? Again, with many people in the world today, sin has no real meaning for them. They don't care about it. But he tells them that the only way to be right with God is to repent of sin and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ in order to receive the forgiveness or the remission of sin. Jesus said this to the earlier disciples in Luke chapter 24, verses 47. And it forms the basis of what Peter says in Acts chapter 2. It is also in that conversation in Luke 24 and verse 49 that the Lord reveals to his disciples that they will be endued with power from on high, which is that Holy Spirit baptism that Mac Deaver erroneously contends that all Christians receive at baptism. The Ethiopian eunuch episode is a clear indication of his awareness of baptism's necessity for salvation and for entrance into the Lord's kingdom, because that is what Philip preached, Acts 8 and verse 12. He had been preached Jesus, which would be the same message he had preached earlier in Samaria and which Peter had preached in Jerusalem. Holy Spirit baptism, that marvelous gift that Mac Deaver talks about, is no longer with us because the apostles are no longer with us. And it has become an issue in the church again because, well, I'll pull back from that a little bit, maybe not entirely because of Mac Deaver, but because of people like Mac Deaver. And we have found, as was mentioned many times before in some of the publications, how these unsuspecting college students at Freed Hardeman in 2014 lectureship, I think his name was Jonathan Jones II, began to talk about this and began to perpetrate this error. And the usual method, of course, to give the impression that the baptism from God upon the apostles was lathered upon a larger group of people that was mentioned in the lectures earlier, trying to assign this to a larger group, 120 people. And this being an indication that Holy Spirit baptism is not exclusive, was not exclusive. And the basic tenet of this erroneous position is that Christians receive the same type of baptism as the apostles in the first century, Acts chapter 2, verses 2 through 5. He, through the Holy Spirit, has given commandments to the apostles whom he have chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion of many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem. Now, we're familiar with these passages of Scripture, where he told them to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you've heard of me. John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days hence. Holy Spirit baptism, as described by Mac Deaver, however, this is a direct operation of the Holy Spirit of God on the eight and many, and depending on which publication you read, is on the alien sinner during the act of water baptism. This is rubbish. But it has somehow gained a foothold in the minds of a lot of people. And it is spreading. It continues to spread. As was said earlier, many brethren thought that this was a dead issue. It wasn't anything that could possibly come up again. How, after you have stomped this out, could it be resurrected when people have become much more intelligent now than they were before? I was watching, now if you want to waste time, watch YouTube. And I was watching YouTube because I was wasting time. And I thought I'd go to a place that, of course, you're going to be quickly entertained. It said something about how smart Americans are. And this fellow was out on the street, and he held up a picture of President Reagan, and he asked this young person, "Do you know who this person is?" I said, "No." I said, "Well, do you know who Brad Pitt is married to?" Bing! They had that like that. Now, I don't know that this is representative of every young person. I wouldn't ascribe that sort of mindset to them. But it does ask us the question of how is it now that this type of error, it continues to swell up? And the young people should know more about this so that they can contend against it, so that in the future they'll be able to fight against it, which again is why we want to commend the brethren here for bringing this issue back to the forefront. Things have to be repeated over and over again. We go now to the one baptism that's described over in the book of Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 5. That phrase, one baptism, has been described in a number of the lectures that have been given so far. And it explicitly states for us that there is only one divine door into the kingdom of God. One action for all whom would enter into the kingdom and by which we may enter. Jesus explicitly said that no one can come to the Father but by through him. John 14, verse 6. And this is through the act of baptism in Galatians chapter 3, verse 27. And the relationship described in Ephesians 4, 5 is obvious. There is only one Lord to whom we belong. One body of truth that joins us to him. And one act that seals us as his. One act, and that baptism for all who confess Jesus Christ. Now it should be easy to understand why one faith and one baptism are attached to one Lord. He is the object of our faith, Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 12. It is into him that we have been baptized, Romans 6 and 3, and again Galatians chapter 3 and verse 27. Additionally, the reference here is to the fact that this baptism was a baptism as a believer in and follower of Jesus Christ. More accurate to translate one baptism as one person in whose name we are baptized, one person for whom we are baptized, or else one purpose for which all of us are baptized. It's a sign of our, is also indicative of our fellowship with Christ, our fellowship with one another. And as we look at this in these particular passages, and here again, the idea of the repetition. I think it was Brother Danny today who was talking about how one gentleman was trying to disparage the idea of the seven ones. But there is only one Lord. There is no other. There is only one faith, the faith that was given once for all times to the saints, Jude 1 or Jude 3. And there is only one baptism, not two. And that allows us into that eternal kingdom. In Acts chapter 19, an incident takes place. And it provides, I think, a clear indication for us that baptism carries a certain weight and importance. Now, in some religious organizations, some religious groups, baptism doesn't really mean very much. It's just an add-on. To some religious groups, it's like the burger with fries. You know, you do it, you get it, but you don't really need it because you're already saved. That's their idea. But here I think we see the importance of it to the extent that Paul doesn't hesitate to ensure, he doesn't hesitate to ensure that it has been properly administered to those who may have been baptized, I'll use the term, improperly. Shows that you cannot be, as they say, taught wrong and baptized right. Nor can there be more than one baptism in effect at the same time. And I think this meeting that takes place in Acts chapter 19 removes any doubt that baptism is significant in another special way. That being that one must be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ according to the New Testament scriptures, or simply put, the plan of salvation. Now let's look at these passages, and in reading them, of course, you've read them, I'm sure, many times. And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus, finding certain disciples, said unto them, have you received the Holy Spirit or Holy Ghost since you believed? And they said unto him, we have not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. And he said unto them, unto what then were you baptized? And they said, unto John's baptism. Then said Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him which should come after him, that is, on Christ Jesus. And when they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. I think that both from the immediate context and from Luke's use of disciples elsewhere in Acts, one must conclude that the disciples referred to here are considered by the apostle when he first meets them, that he thinks that they are New Testament Christians, having been baptized into Christ for the remission of sin. Not, he doesn't think of them immediately as John's disciples. And then he asked the question, under what then were you baptized? Have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? Now that also brings up a whole new section of inquiry as to the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and I'll get back to that. But he knows now that they have not been baptized into Christ. And the question also assumes, and the actions by Paul that follow, that there is a firm bond between proper baptism and salvation. And that there is a baptism in this case which is no longer in force. Now we point these out for a number of reasons. Some would try to deny that Paul considered them. Well, there are a number of different reasons. I put that in the book. I want to move on past that. You can read through there if you get the opportunity. But the point that I want to look at here is that the baptism of John was no longer in force as New Testament church was now in existence. So they were not saved. And having been administered John's baptism after the events in Acts chapter 2, and thus had not yet put on Christ or yet been added by Christ to his church, Paul brought about the remedy with a clearer teaching and understanding of those events that had transpired. Now this brings us now to MacDeaver, or at least brings me there. I believe that MacDeaver has pigeonholed himself in error on the subject of Holy Spirit baptism. And he has written a number of articles, books on the subject recently. He has also made what could be described, well, at least I put it in the book, as the most asinine as a direct result of their consistently contradictory nature statements in the Brotherhood on the topic. Some of the things Brother Ken wouldn't let me put in the book. That's okay, I can say it now. Matt claims that both water and spirit baptism are involved in one's entering the kingdom, and that these two baptisms occur. Now, I want you to hold on to somebody next to you or to the seat in front of you. He claims that these two baptisms occur both simultaneously and at different times. Now, I'm going to read first from a publication, Biblical Notes Quarterly, in spring 2011. I claim that to be a Christian, one has to be immersed in both elements. And if water is an element, a thing to be baptized in John 3:5, there is no hermeneutical basis upon which to conclude that spirit is not equally an element as is the water itself. That's 1 Corinthians 12:13, John 7:37 through 39. Cleansing has to do with forgiveness, and that takes place when one is baptized into water. If we make a claim for the baptism of the Spirit, now I recognize that there is always the possibility of learning more. You can not understand something clearly. I turned to Michael Hatcher to ask him if he understood it, or maybe I misunderstood what was said. I'm going to read this. If we make a claim for the baptism of the Spirit, we are claiming that the Holy Spirit immerses the human spirit, or that the human spirit is submerged in the Holy Spirit. Let me read that again. Did I get that right? Claiming that the Holy Spirit immerses the human spirit, or that the human spirit is submerged in the Holy Spirit. This event is the event referred to as regeneration, as per Titus 3:5. But regeneration is not cleansing. Regeneration is the act of generating again. It is a spiritual revitalization, a coming into spiritual life again. And logically speaking, would follow the cleansing. In baptism, the sinner is forgiven or cleansed. He is regenerated, and then he is indwelled. Why this order? Because cleansing must precede regeneration, or man would be regenerated while yet in sin. Now, I'm going to hear it from Brother Denham at one point or another, but I'm sure he contradicted this later. The regenerated person is the person whose nature is changed. He has a new spiritual life because he is in a new way associated with God, or in a spiritual fellowship with God. Now, before man can be given the indwelling of the Spirit, now he's given the indwelling of the Spirit because somehow he's received this indwelling as the Holy Spirit immersed him. He must be regenerated by the Spirit so that the nature is changed. As a man's body is lowered in the water, the metaphysical aspects of this are just intriguing. And Brother Denham has done great work on this. As a man's body is lowered in the water, when it is submerged in the water, the Holy Spirit submerges that man's human spirit within himself to change his nature. And at the very precise moment, how he knows this, when God considers the man no longer sinner but now saint, at that precise instant, the regenerating, submerging spirit moves from the outside to the inside of that heart. Now, these quotes reveal something very troubling about the way a person thinks and understands baptism and scripture and logic, it seems to me. But he is determined to view baptism as a twofold process, water baptism, then spirit baptism, and one where ultimately following to a natural conclusion, one would not have to be baptized at all to become a Christian. He also claims that both of these baptisms take place simultaneously. Now, aren't you confused? I read what Brother Denham wrote on it several times, and I was still confused. And I knew he wasn't confused. Also, in Acts, where he states in Acts chapter 8, that the Samaritans received spirit baptism sometime after their water baptism through the laying on of the hands of the apostles, Peter and John, and that the household of Cornelius received spirit baptism before water baptism as exceptions to his interpretations of John 3, verse 5. This was also in the Biblical Notes Quarterly, Spring 2011, and his book, The Holy Spirit, Center of Controversy, I'll say, Basis of Unity. Not likely. Now, here is where I had to stop for a moment and I had to go see Brother Denham because, again, I could be wrong. And I asked him a question and he said he doesn't know the answer either. So I know I'm rightly confused. Now, even though I'm looking at the fatal error that Mac teaches and believes about John 3:5, I need what I describe as an assessment of how indescribable Mac's methodology for Bible interpretation is with reference to Acts 8 and the Samaritans receiving the various gifts from the laying on the apostles' hands in the same Biblical Notes Quarterly. Now, I really don't know how you're going to take this. Laying on of apostolic hands. And we know the story in Acts chapter 8, where it was through the laying on, it says quite clearly in the scriptures, through the laying on of the apostles' hands. But here he says the laying on of apostolic hands does not mean that the apostles were the source of the Spirit being given in the sense that in Acts 8 and Acts 19. Their hands provided the identification of those to receive the Holy Spirit of God. Yeah, that's right. Their hands provided the identification of those to receive the Holy Spirit from God. Now that sounds to me like you're trying to target somebody with a drone. It sounds like something out of the X-Files. I mean, God does not need spotters. He said the apostles could only give the Spirit in the sense of identifying by the laying on of their hands those to whom the Spirit was to be given. And I as I read that, and I thought, well, I don't want to go up here and sound stupid. And I said, Brother Denham, could you come out here for a second? Did you see there where he said how this God needed to identify these people? And the undeniable implication made in the statements above that God needs someone to identify those who receive the gifts, that's nearly blasphemous. Let me see the scripture. Now, when Simon saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hand, the Holy Spirit was given, that's pretty simple. I think you can read that. He offered them money, saying, give me this power that anyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit. Not on anyone I lay my hands, they may be identified. So, this is twisted thinking. This is not logic, and it's quite unscriptural. And Mac has continually and inexplicably, he is attempting to tie Holy Spirit baptism with water baptism. His use of the words elements clearly an effort to obscure an interpretive problem that he sees these elements as distinct from each other rather than elements of one act of baptism. He views this process as one in which a subject is first baptized in water, then the Holy Spirit. Now, there are so many things wrong with this teaching, and I put Brother Denham's name in here. He has spent years refuting this publicly. And I had to, at San Mateo, when we put out the bulletins and when we put out the various publications, were primarily Contending and Defender, and many times they see the article after article, month after month after month, that Brother Deaver was writing, the Holy Spirit baptism, era of the Holy, and they would look at me and just wonder, how many of these articles are there? I said, well, we're going to go over it in class. You'll find out. But he can't deny, and Brother Hatcher brought this up also, he can't deny that this will eventually have to lead to miracles. You can't get past it. Now, there's another long series of commentary here that I'm guessing I'm not going to have enough time to read.
I'm guessing that too.
But it is a set of some paragraphs by Brother Denham that was in a 2011 issue of The Defender. So I urge you to read it. And of course you know that over the years there's been the attempt to bring Brother Deaver into a debate. And I think that, as we've said before, if any time that you know that you're wrong, you don't really want to have that on public display. But I think that what Brother Denham shows in the articles that he has written, and part of which I've copied in the chapter, shows here and with copious documentation and follow-up articles that it is this dangerous doctrine of spirit baptism, that it lacks an inner logic even before one need ascertain its possible hermeneutical value for debate. Now, what that tells me is that the 7 minutes I gave up the other night, you don't get them back. Well, I urge you to, if you get an opportunity, read the chapter and my closing comments on Brother Deaver. I hope you see how ridiculous that doctrine that he is trying to propagate sounds, and that the leaders from the various congregations will continue to teach on it and will continue to put it down. One more time. Thank you.
Thank you, Johnny, for such a fine lesson. You know, I've always thought that people have a right to be stupid, but they don't have a right to expect you to be stupid. And just because somebody's stupid does not necessarily mean that you can ascribe that to some sort of mental disorder. That's why I changed your, manuscript. So. You know, one of the advantages of a series of lessons such as is this, that we might be informed as to what the truth is on a particular matter. But in learning what the truth is on a particular matter, it's always good to learn what error people teach. And that's what Johnny has tried to present here, both the truth on the matter and the error that is taught. One thing that we want to do, I think you talked about intellect. You know, intellect is a sort of a moving target. And a lot of it has to do with education. Educating people as to what is the right thing. And people, when they feel a need to know a particular subject, when they feel that it is essential to whatever they consider important, they'll learn that subject. If, you know, some sort of farming technique is essential to the well-being of that farmer will learn that technique, but he may not know anything about computers. It's not important to him. In religion, what is important to the individual, they will learn it. Unfortunately, by and large today in the denominational world, is just not important. What is important is, am I going to get that free Easter basket? And that's about it. And, you know, what's important to someone like a Mac Deaver, you can find out what's important to him from what he espouses. And since he espouses it, you can examine it in light of the truth. And that's the advantage of lectureships such as this. So we appreciate those lessons, Johnny, and we hope to hear more from you and from subsequent speakers tonight and tomorrow. We'll be dismissed now until the top of the hour, at which time we'll introduce our next speaker.